Please welcome Günther Oettinger, European Commissioner for Budget and Human Resources.
Dear President Dennis Snower, dear Sebastian Turner, dear Member of the European Parliament, Viviane Reding, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for inviting me. I may say, I think it's an impressive program in these days here in Berlin, with a clear outlook to G20 July in Hamburg this year, and with a clear vision what should happening in the European Union and beyond, and how to come to a coherent picture from industry and economy to social affairs and to our whole society. We are living in a competition of different orders of values, and competition between different systems. Me and all of you born after World War II, we have been educated by American and British and French partners, by our parents in our schools and high schools, and our values are democracy, rule of law, social market economy, freedom of speech, of religion, or of media and press, checks and balances. And behind all of this, it's in Europe a more or less Jewish Christian idea of man. And last 60 years, we have been quite successful. We had a high level of acceptance inside our European family, from 6 founding member states to now 28. But beyond as well, from Norway to Switzerland, to the West Balkan countries. So our values have been attractive. But now we are seeing more and more, with our order of values, we are living in a competition. There are other systems, other forms of governance, other values. May it be one party and a clear industrial policy coming from Beijing and Shanghai. May it be autocrats in Ankara, in Moscow, and maybe in one wing of the White House in Washington, D.C. Nobody knows. G7 and our NATO event have been special. And so I think more and more we have to see how to stabilize our European family, our European project, with Brexit, our EU27 family, and what is our responsibility together with other partners in a global dimension. We are checking in these days, where do we see added value? Working together or coming to a European competence? Just a few examples. Looking back to Copenhagen 2009, there are times we had no European mandate. Copenhagen, the Danish government, was the organizer, was the host. 28 countries of Europe have been present. But at the end, when important heads of state and government decided to do nothing, to have no agreement, no European was inside this informal meeting fair times. Paris, 2015. There was a European mandate. The Commission, the Barroso Commission, prepared a 2030 outlook and a 2050 outlook with clear obligatory plannings for how to reduce CO2 and greenhouse gas emissions. And at the end of the Paris conference, it was a huge global agreement. Maybe now the US are checking to go back, but anyway, Paris and Marrakech, there wasn't clear added value why Europe was united. There was a European Union position, and we have been negotiating together with our French partners on a common European basis. Take the digital sector, for which I was co-responsible last 2 years. For the moment, we have no digital single market. And we are lagging behind. In a digital revolution, our US friends and South Korea, Israel, and maybe China are leading the global technological development. We are sure to have one data protection regulation, to have one cyber security strategy, to develop 5G cross-border all over Europe, or take research programs as micro and nano electronics are, or quantum technologies, or photonic, robotic, sensoric, or high performance computing. No member state stand alone. No company stand alone. Not Siemens, not Bosch, not Philips, not Schneider Electric. Not Germany, not France, not Italy stand alone. Is able to invest such an amount of money, and nobody has enough human resources, but together as a joint undertaking, a public-private partnership, our industries, member states, and the European Commission, investing together, being a European research and innovation team. I'm sure we are competitive in a global competition with South Korea, China, Japan, and with our OTTs coming from Silicon Valley, California. Clear added value. Our main challenge, I think, is Africa. Neighborhood is destiny. Africa is our direct neighbor, not the neighbor of the US, not the neighbor of Asia. Africa is doubling the number of citizens in next 30 years from 1.5 billion to up to 3 billion. And we have an ongoing refugee crisis. So we have to invest into a perspective for young Africans in Egypt, in Mali, in Nigeria, in Niger, in Libya, in Algeria. For the moment, in Europe, nearly nobody is really interested. We are interested when these people coming via the Mediterranean to Lampedusa, to Greece, and at the end of the day to Munich, Berlin, and Copenhagen. And then the reaction is that we have populistic votes when we have national and regional elections. We are speaking about refugees in the crisis of 2015, 16, and 17. Nobody is analyzing how to avoid refugees 2025. They all are born, being 3, 5, 10, 12 years old, living in unstable regions, being violated from ISIS to dictatorship, being hungry, having no education, and it's not really in our focus. I think we have to come to a culture to learn to share, a culture to learn to share, you and me, all together. If our generation is not willing to come to a culture to learn to share, we are damaging the future of our kids. I think to export values, to export freedom, to export peace is more important than to export S-class cars. No doubt, to export machines and cars and trucks is important in a market-based economy. Looking to the success story of the German industry in these days. But I'm sure from Serbia to Egypt, from Iraq to Algeria, to export freedom, values, and peace is the most important export. And we all have to do more and to do better for to avoid refugees 2025. Our European Union is in a kind of a crisis, no doubt. But if we compare Europe with other continents, do you know any other continent which is so united, coordinated, working together, cross-border? Europe was the continent of bitter enmity and war and sorrow in the 17th, 19th, and 20th century. Now we have 70 years of peace. We have common values. Beyond 25 languages, beyond several religions, beyond our difficult history, we are working together. More than Mexicans and the US are working together in these days, more than South America is working together, more than the tigers of Asia are working together, more than Africa is united. So beyond all problems, 25 languages, histories, several religions, and a European Union. With more and more common sense, common understanding, common approach, and common competencies. And we need more Europe, I'm sure. Take G20. For the moment, G20 is about 5,000 million citizens. 19 countries plus EU. 5,000 million. Europe with UK, 500, without 440. So less than 10%. On a midterm, we need one member in G20, because there are coming new countries, countries with increasing population, with an increasing GDP. At the end of the day, we need one member. It's the European Union itself. Not Italy, not UK, not France, not Germany, and so on. Because if you have less than 10% of the whole population, you can't have 30% of all members. Take G7, last days looking back. It's Canada, Japan, the US, okay. But in addition, it's France, Italy, UK, Germany, plus Jean-Claude Juncker, plus Donald Tusk. 6 of 9 G7 members are Europeans. Do you think that in 2050 it can be ongoing, 6 of 9? Never. Forget it. So we should come to one voice and one membership and one vote, an European vote, in a close partnership with the US and with Canada and Japan and others. Take IMF. There's one shareholder, one country having a veto right. It's the US. And we have several shareholders, all member states of the EU, but nobody, not Germany nor France, has a veto right. If we would bring together our shares as a European, as one European shareholder, we would be a major shareholder, bigger than the US, we would have a veto right. We would work on the same level as Washington, D.C. I think clear added value. But it's a question of power. Is Berlin, Paris, Rome, Den Haag, are they willing to give power from their own government to the council in Brussels. I think on a midterm they should do. Because to do it coming from a strong position is better than to be 2035 in a weak position and having no other option. I think there is a clear added value for more and more political fields to work together to be a European Union. And as a European Union, in close friendship to the US or not, we have new responsibilities, because Africa is our neighbor continent, and because our responsibility is our own responsibility, from defense policy to development aid, from digital to energy, and so on. Thank you all for preparing G20 in Hamburg in July this year. And we are really interested to get your constructive and critical advice. What is your expectation to our European Commission, knowing what is happening in Hamburg, what is happening globally, and which responsibility Europe as a United Union can take, and how and where do we see Europe in 2030? Because at the moment we are checking our own position. Maybe the Brexit is a damage for London and for Brussels, but it's a chance. EU27 has to do better than ever EU28 has been doing. Thank you all.